Counterpoint, the General Knowledge Music Quiz, chaired by Paul Gambaccini.
Hello. You join us for another Counterpoint contest in which our players are taking part from the comfort of their own homes. We're doing our best to make sure we can hear our contestants without too many gaps or delays, and they can hear the varied selection of music we've got for them. Let's meet our faraway friends.
Hello, I'm EUGENE GALLAGHER, and I'm a recently retired computer analyst from Chester.
My name is Helen Shrimpton. I live on the Wirral, and I'm a pensions administrator.
And hello, I'm Donna Whitehouse from Cheltenham in Gloucestershire, and I'm an account business manager for a global technology company.
Welcome, all of you. In the opening round, we ask you musical general knowledge questions for 2 points apiece. We go round in alphabetical order of surname. If you can't get the right answer to your own question, it will pass to the others for a possible bonus point. Good luck, everyone. EUGENE GALLAGHER, the first question is for you. 30 years ago, a study claimed that listening to Mozart for 10 minutes a day can improve performance in spatial reasoning tasks and boost intelligence. This approach was popularized in 1997 by which Donald Campbell book?
It's something about how Mozart can make your baby smarter.
Well, it's something remotely like that, but actually it wasn't that. So we're going to turn it over to Helen Shrimpton.
I'm afraid I'll have to pass.
And she passes the baton to Donna Whitehouse.
No.
The book was actually called The Mozart Effect. Helen Shrimpton, let's see what effect 30 seconds of Mozart has on you. For your first musical extract, here's the third movement of which of the composer's popular works?
Marriage of Figaro?
I'm sorry, that was not from the Marriage of Figaro. Does EUGENE GALLAGHER have a clue?
It's Mozart's Horn Concerto No. 4.
Correct. The soloist you heard was Barry Tuckwell. Donna Whitehouse, in October 2020, the British singer-songwriter Adele made jokes about her weight loss during an appearance as guest host of which American late-night television sketch comedy show?
Saturday Night Live?
It was Saturday Night Live. The series had previously helped to launch her career in America. EUGENE GALLAGHER, here are Gladys Knight and the Pips with a song composed by an American singer who died in October 2020. When you've heard it, I'd like you to give me his name.
I can see clearly now. I can see all obstacles in my way. Gone are the dark clouds that had me blind. It's gonna be a bright, bright sunshine day.
Johnny Nash?
Johnny Nash was the man who wrote I Can See Clearly Now. And of course, although that was Gladys Knight and the Pips, it was not Gladys Knight. It was one of the Pips. Helen Shrimpton, the rock star Eddie Van Halen died in the same month as Johnny Nash. Van Halen's biggest hit in the UK was Jump, which was taken from an album that shares its name with a dystopian work of fiction. What's that title?
Brave New World.
Oh, I'm sorry. Donna Whitehouse?
1984.
Correct for the bonus point. And Donna, here's your own question. We hear now from Elvis Presley and Rockahula Baby. It's from the soundtrack of a film directed by Norman Taurog, which is 60 years old in this year of 2021. After we've moved our hips, I'd like you to name the movie.
The way she moves her hips up to her fingertips, I feel I'm heaven bound. And when she starts to sway, I've got to say, she really moves the grass around. Rock, a hula baby, rock, a hula baby got a hula loop from Honolulu. That rock a hula baby of mine.
Blue Hawaii?
It was Blue Hawaii for 2 points. You really moved the grass around. EUGENE GALLAGHER, one of the most consistently successful record labels of the 1970s, was founded by Mickey Most. In its peak years, 1973 to 75, it achieved 40 hit singles with performers including Hot Chocolate, Mud, Cozy Powell, Smokey, and Susie Quattro. Which label is that?
R-A-K.
That's right, Rack Records. Helen Shrimpton, more 70s music, this time from the Mo West label. Can you name this 1972 release by Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons and the famous dance scene in which it's regarded as a classic?
Begging?
No, that's the wrong title, but do you know the area of club culture in which that was famous?
Northern Soul.
Northern Soul. So you get 1 point, and now we turn over to Donna Whitehouse for the possible bonus point for the title of that song.
No, don't know.
EUGENE?
The Night.
It was The Night, and you get the bonus point. Donna Whitehouse, in March 1961, at the age of 16, which British cellist made their formal debut at Wigmore Hall, London, accompanied by Ernest Lush, playing sonatas by Handel, Brahms, and Debussy?
Jacqueline Dupre?
It was Jacqueline Dupre. EUGENE GALLAGHER, time for some Wagner, and part of the prelude to the third act of an opera whose premiere was at Weimar in 1850, conducted by Franz Liszt. Which opera is this?
I think that's Lohengrin.
That is Lohengrin, the Act 3 prelude. You get 2 points. Helen Shrimpton, a special Grammy concert in 2019 saw John Legend, Celine Dion, Jennifer Hudson, Kelly Clarkson, and many others perform songs including Respect, A Change Is Gonna Come, and Bridge Over Troubled Water as part of a tribute event for which artist?
Aretha Franklin?
That's right. It was called Aretha, a Grammy Celebration for the Queen of Soul. Donna Whitehouse, finally in this round, a song from a Doctor Who actor performing on a BBC Children in Need fundraising album. After you've heard Yellow, I'd like you to name her along with the band who originally released the song.
Look at the stars, look how they shine for you. And everything you do, yeah, they were all yellow. I came along, I wrote a song for you, and all the things you do, and it was called Yellow.
Billy Piper?
Oh, I'm sorry, it was not Billy Piper. And although we will turn over to EUGENE for that part of the question, the other part was who originated the song?
Blur?
No, I'm sorry. So it looks like we'll be turning over to EUGENE for both parts of that.
Okay, it's Coldplay and Jodie Whittaker.
That's right. You get the bonus point. And so the scores after our opening round are in third place with 3 points, Helen Shrimpton. Lying second with 7 points, Donna Whitehouse. And in the lead with 9 points, EUGENE GALLAGHER. Our second round is the individual round, in which our competitors answer their own questions on a musical category or theme from a list which I'm about to give them. This is the first time they've heard these choices. They've had no chance to prepare. Let me reveal today's topics. A history lesson. Plays set to music, power ballads, Marvin Gaye, Classical Storms. You choose in the order of your scores at this stage. So, Eugene, you're in the lead. Which would you like?
I'll go for Classical Storms.
And Donna Whitehouse, your choice?
Power Ballads.
And you get Power Ballads, which leaves three for Helen, a history lesson, plays set to music, and Marvin Gaye.
Marvin Gaye.
Let's start with Helen Shrimpton and your questions on Marvin Gaye. Marvin's early career with Tamla Motown was mostly spent working on sessions with Stevie Wonder, the Supremes, and the Marvelettes. Playing what instrument?
Guitar?
No, it was the drums. Marvin's 1960s successes included a number of collaborations with other Motown artists. Can you identify his duet partner here?
If you need me, call me, no matter where you are, no matter how far.
Don't worry, baby.
Just call my name, I'll be there in a hurry. You don't have to worry.
Oh, baby, now ain't no mountain high enough. Ain't no valley low enough. Ain't no river wide enough.
It's Tommy Terrell.
It is Tammy Terrell for 2 points. The composers of Ain't No Mountain High Enough were a successful husband and wife songwriting and production team. They penned other hits for Gaye and Terrell, too, including You're All I Need to Get By and Ain't Nothing Like the Real Thing. Can you name them?
Is it Carole King and Jeffrey Goffin?
Oh, I'm sorry. It was not. It was Nicholas Ashford and Valerie Simpson, who were the only people to stand me up in their own house. I was there to interview them, and they would not come downstairs. Here's the title track of one of Gaye's most revered albums. Your question will follow.
Mother, mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today.
The groundbreaking album What's Going On produced two further hit singles that made the Billboard Top 10 in 1971. Both explored deep social themes. Can you name either of them?
Let's Get It On.
I'm sorry, it would have been correct to say either Mercy, Mercy Me, The Ecology, or Inner City Blues Makes Me Wanna Holler. Let's Get It On was a separate album. In the 70s, Gaye's 13th studio album, Let's Get It On, was described by music reviewers as one of the most sexually charged albums ever recorded. The title track has been in the news recently as the heirs of its co-writer Ed Townsend sued a British singer claiming he'd ripped off the, quote, melody, harmony, and rhythm compositions, unquote, of the Gaye classic on his record, Thinking Out Loud. What's the defendant's name?
Ed Sheeran.
Correct. Of course, Ed Sheeran was born after Let's Get It On was released. Marvin Gaye's first single release after his departure from Motown was this song, Sexual Healing. When you've heard it, I'd like you to name the 1982 album on which it originally appeared.
Is it Sexual Healing?
I'm sorry, the album is not called Sexual Healing. It's Midnight Love. After Gaye's untimely death in 1984, his friends were quick to pay musical tribute. Diana Ross recorded the Lionel Richie song Missing You, but which hit song recorded by the Commodores after Lionel Richie's departure contains the line, Marvin sang of the joy and pain. He opened up our minds.
Pass.
It was Night Shift. The song also references Jackie Wilson, who died a few months before Marvin Gaye. And Helen Shrimpton, in that round, you have scored 4 points. Donna Whitehouse, here is your choice of power ballads. The sisters Anne and Nancy Wilson are members of which American rock band whose hits include These Dreams and Alone?
Heart.
That's right. Power ballads are described by the Oxford Dictionary as slow, soft rock songs with a strong emotional vocal delivery and often grandiose production. A definition underlined here by which group?
Bon Jovi.
It is Bon Jovi with Always. Total Eclipse of the Heart, Bonnie Tyler's number one song from 1983, was written and produced by a man who'd previously composed Meatloaf's Bat Out of Hell, one of the top albums of all time. Can you name him?
I've got the album and I can't think. Steinman.
That's right, Jim Steinman. Steinman also worked on the duet between Meatloaf and Cher, Dead Ringer for Love. Here's a solo offering from Cher with a question afterwards. The video for Cher's If I Could Turn Back Time caused a bit of a stir. It showed her performing for the Navy in a provocative outfit aboard the USS Missouri. In 1945, the battleship had been the location for which historic event?
Pearl Harbor?
No, the reverse. The surrender of Imperial Japan was formally signed on board, bringing the hostilities of World War II to a close. The 1980s song Broken Wings by Mr. Mister was inspired by a 1912 novel of that title by Khalil Gibran. Lyricist John Lang incorporated the author's line, "Take these broken wings and learn to fly," a line which the Beatles had also used some years earlier for which song?
Hey Jude?
No, it was Blackbird. Take these broken wings and learn to fly. Tina Turner's What's Love Got to Do With It has recently been remixed and re-released by Norwegian producer Kygo. But here's the original from Tina's fifth solo studio album that launched her 1980s comeback. After you've heard it, I'd like you to name the album.
What's Love Got to Do With It?
No, it was Private Dancer.
Of course.
Finally, which 1980s number one power ballad features backing vocals from Dreamgirls star Jennifer Holliday, the gospel sounds of the New Jersey Mass Choir, and includes the lyric, "In my life, there's been heartache and pain"?
Yeah, I don't know if you can do it again. Oh, I know it, and I just can't get to the next line.
Here she is, folks, on Zoom, as she tries to remember the karaoke classic by Foreigner, I Want to Know What Love Is.
I want to know. Oh, yes.
And I want to know what your score is after that round. Donna Whitehouse, you've scored 6 points. We move right along to EUGENE GALLAGHER and his classical storms. Which composer depicted at least two storms in his operas, in the second act of The Barber of Seville, and perhaps most famously, in the overture to his last opera, William Tell?
Rossini.
Yes. Which Verdi opera opens with this vivid storm scene?
I think that's a cello.
It is a cello. Which symphonic poem by Richard Strauss, first performed in Berlin in 1915, depicts the ascent of a mountain with a mighty storm to be faced on the descent?
The Alpine Symphony?
That is correct for 2 points. A thunderstorm, as depicted by Beethoven. Which symphony is this?
That's the Sixth Symphony.
That's correct. Symphony number 6, the Pastoral. The third movement of which orchestral work by Berlioz depicts distant thunder as evoked on timpani?
Symphony Fantastique.
2 points. Music from a Hitchcock movie. A question will follow. The dramatic climax to Arthur Benjamin's Storm Clouds Cantata. It provides a musical background to the assassination scene in a 1934 Hitchcock film, which he remade in 1956 with James Stewart and Doris Day. Which movie?
The Man Who Knew Too Much.
That's right. Hitch's usual composer of choice, Bernard Herrmann, can be seen conducting the cantata in the movie. Your last question in this round on classical storms is this. Which 1931 orchestral suite by Ferdy Grofi features a stormy cloudburst towards the end?
It's the Grand Canyon Suite.
It is the Grand Canyon Suite. And so, EUGENE GALLAGHER, in that round you scored 14 points. After the individual round, here's how things stand. Lying third with 7 points is Helen Shrimpton. In second place with 13 points, it's Donna Whitehouse. And our leader with just 1 round to go with 23 points is EUGENE GALLAGHER. It all stands or falls on the final round. I'm going to ask our 3 contestants in turn as many questions as they can answer in the space of a minute. A correct answer wins them 1 point, with nothing deducted for a wrong answer. There are no bonuses. We start with the contestant lying third. That's you, Helen Shrimpton. Your minute starts now. Which American blues singer, born in Mississippi in 1925, named his guitar Lucille?
Bo Diddley.
No, B.B. King. Whose album releases include Back to the World and Superfly?
Curtis Mayfield.
Yes. Schubert's Symphony No. 8 in B minor is generally known by what title?
The Fourth Symphony.
Unfinished. With which ballet company was Rudolf Nureyev touring when he defected to the West in 1961?
The Royal Ballet.
It was the Kirov Ballet. Anne Dudley composed the score to which BBC TV drama series starring Aidan Turner in the title role?
Poldark.
Yes. Which Arctic Monkeys song begins with the lines, "So who's that girl there? I wonder what went wrong."
When the Sun Goes Down?
Yes. How many symphonies did Brahms compose?
12.
No, 4. Who composed the music? And Helen Shrimpton, in your minute, you scored 3 points, which brings us to Donna Whitehouse. Your minute starts now. The famous Red Special guitar was built and designed with his father by which British guitarist?
Blind May.
Yes. Which band's albums include Angel Delight and What We Did on Our Holidays?
Fairport Convention.
Yes. What slow tempo did Dvorak use for the second movement of his New World Symphony?
Largo.
Correct. I'll Be There for You, the theme from American comedy series Friends, is supplied by which band?
The Rembrandts.
You're right. Which Drifter song begins with the line, "Oh, when the sun beats down and burns the tar up on the roof"?
Sitting by the Dock of the Bay.
Under the Boardwalk. Elgar composed two concertos, one for the cello and the other for...
clarinet.
Violin. Which sci-fi actor released the 1993 album Highly Illogical?
Leonard Nimoy.
Yes. In which film musical does Howard Keel play Wild Bill Hickok?
Calamity Jane.
You're right. The Green Man in Wales and the Big Tent in Scotland are music festivals mainly devoted to which genre of music?
Celtic.
It is folk music. And Donna Whitehouse, in that round, you got 6 points. And we come to the third round for EUGENE GALLAGHER, whose minute starts now. Which American country singer, born in Texas in 1933, named his guitar Trigger?
Hank Williams?
No, it was Willie Nelson. Whose album releases include Caught Up and It Hurts So Good?
Millie Jackson.
Millie Jackson is correct. Beethoven's last 6 major compositions from 1825-26 are usually known by what name?
The Late String Quartets.
Yes, the Late Quartets. Which song by Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds is used as the main theme for the BBC TV series Peaky Blinders?
Red Right Hand.
Yes. Which Charlie Pride song begins with the line, "Down at the railroad station, there's people getting on"?
Oh, pass.
I'm just me. In which musical does James Cagney play composer George M. Cohan?
Yankee Doodle Dandy.
And he won the Oscar. What name is given to a type of musical texture consisting of 2 or more simultaneous lines of independent melody?
A counterpoint?
Polyphony. The Vatican holds a parchment date. And EUGENE GALLAGHER, in that round, you scored 4 points. And so, at the end of today's heat of Counterpoint, the final scores are 3rd with 10 points is Helen Shrimpton, runner-up with 19 points is Donna Whitehouse, and our winner, with a staggering 27 points, EUGENE GALLAGHER. Well done, EUGENE GALLAGHER. We'll be meeting you again in the semifinals, and of course, we say thank you and commiserations to the other 2 after an entertaining contest. If you've missed any of the details of the music we've played today, it's all listed on the Counterpoint pages on the BBC website. Please join us next time. Goodbye.